Good morning and welcome to worship. It's so good that you could join us. Thank you for being with us today. Whether you're a regular or this is your first time joining us on our video service, thank you for being part of our church today as we explore what we can learn from the poorest of the poor and what COP26 might mean for all of us. We're going to start our time together bringing our concerns, our joys, our sadnesses, our worries to God. So we're going to pray for ourselves. Let's pray together. Let us pray. We meet as family in the presence of our Heavenly Father. We meet as siblings in Christ, accepting the responsibilities this places upon us to love one another as you have loved us. We meet as your lights in this dark world and pray that through our words and our lives, others might be drawn into your family and accept you as their Saviour and Lord. In our meeting together, let us remember that we worship the God who created this world, the God who spoke through prophets from generation to generation, led people from captivity to liberty, healed the sick, fed the hungry, was faithful even when faced with rejection. We come to you. The same God who wants all people to be drawn to God's love and grace, to know forgiveness and joy of salvation. Let us put aside all that hinders and join together in worship and praise, for this is the day the Lord has made. This is the day when you, O God, can be found. God of all, breath of life, living water, Saviour, friend. We come as the hungry to feed on God's word. We come as the thirsty to drink of God's love. We come as the faithful to worship you, Lord of all. Amen. We come singing to our Lord. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Our readings are from 1 Kings and from the Gospel according to Mark. And we hear these words.
Then the word of the Lord came to him.
Go at once to Zarephath of Sidon and stay there. I have commanded a widow in that place to supply you with food.
So he went to Zarephath. When he came to the town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and asked,
Would you bring me a little water in a jar so I may have a drink?
As she was going to get it, he called.
And bring me, please, a piece of bread.
As surely as the Lord your God lives,
she replied,
I don't have any bread, only a handful of flour in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I am gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die.
Elijah said to her,
Don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said. But first make a small cake of bread for me, from what you have and bring it to me. And then make something for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. The jar of flour will not be used up, and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord gives rain on the land.
She went away and did as Elijah had told her. So there was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and her family. For the jar of flour was not used up, and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken by Elijah.
Jesus denounces the scribes. As he taught, he said, "Beware of the scribes, who like to walk around in long robes and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and to have the best seats in the synagogues and places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses and for the sake of appearance say long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation." The widow's offering. He sat down opposite the treasury and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then he called his disciples and said to them, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she had to live on."
Take my life, Lord, let it be. Imagine just for a minute that you are at a mega church, one of those huge stadium type congregations that you see on the television, where congregations number in their hundreds. Up front, the pastor leading the worship is preaching about how God will multiply whatever you financially give to him. And he's dressed in his expensive suit. Occasionally flashes his pricey watch. And after this, he'll drive his luxurious car back to his lavish home. Near you in the seats is a woman who's just been deserted by her husband. Mother of two small children. Her poorly paying job was just made redundant. And it'll be some weeks before she receives her universal credit benefit. But you watch as she puts in what you know to be all she has as the collection plate comes by. How do you feel? I think most of us would be appalled and horrified, and people are right to react to scandalous hypocrisy of religion and the leadership that encourages that kind of action. So why should Jesus react any less? So let's look at how our reading starts. It says, Jesus taught in the temple and said, "Beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes and be greeted with respect in the marketplaces, have the best seats in the synagogue, the places of honour at banquets. They devour widows' houses. And for the sake of appearances, they say long prayers, but they receive the greatest condemnation." In our story from Mark, Jesus isn't praising the widow. He's showing the widow to be an illustration of religious abuse. Because Jesus has no sooner condemned the religious leaders than he draws attention to the example right there and right then that illustrates his point. We need to be crystal clear here. Jesus isn't against long robes or cassocks. I mean, guess what Jesus is wearing? He's not against being greeted with respect, nor against even having church buildings. The story starts with men who are trying to appear super holy by dressing up. And Jesus says that is misleading. And then we look at money and he says, they are seemingly generous. And Jesus says that is misleading. The story continues with the temple, which appears to be so great. And Jesus says, well, that's misleading. True holiness isn't in the robes. It's in the way you care for each other. The way you care for others, for yourself, for the world. True generosity isn't in the amount you give. It's something far richer. The true temple where God abides isn't a building. As we reflect on the story, we have to be cautious about our interpretation that the Bible reinforces about our prejudice. Because rather than challenging us, we can take from it that, well, the church should be getting every penny that we all have. When actually, we know that there are times that we can give, and there are times that we should give more, and we could give more, and we choose not to, like the scribes. That we're more concerned about looking like we give a lot, looking like we are super religious, looking like and sounding like and acting like great church members, but actually not putting in. And we know that we're blessed. We know we have enough. We know that we could give more of our time, of our talents, and financially. But we also know that not everyone has that luxury. And many of us at times in our lives have faced months when the money coming in was less than the money going out. We know that. God knows that. And frankly, God would rather his children were fed than money given to keep up appearances. Because God knows. God alone knows that when we have nothing or next to nothing, we are closer to God than we have ever been. Because God gets our everything. God gets our tears, our prayers, our cries, our promises. And God is thanked for every last bean in that can, every free cuppa at a church coffee morning. And God does not need your coins at that point because you've already given all that you have. In generosity out of your poverty. What Jesus is getting at are the scribes who make out that they give so much, but actually, in reality, compared to what they actually have, they're given the bare minimum. So we shouldn't come to the passage and say, oh, we should be like the widow. We should never use the Bible as a weapon against people for the benefit of ourselves. We should reinforce the widow's might rather than her might, her strength of character, her determination to show those that have made her homeless and penniless, going against the law of God as dictated in the scriptures, may I add, showing those scribes hanging around the temple looking holy, showing them the best that she can, that she can still worship God, that she can still come to the temple to be part of our community. She can still give a donation, albeit at a level beyond sacrificial. In our other story, the widow and her son are on the brink of starvation. They're provided with an oil jug that will not run dry and a stash of grain that will never be empty.
The widow of Zarephath, despite having only enough to make a small bannock for her and her son to share before crawling into a corner to die, still offers welcome, still offers hospitality, still shows generosity beyond all bounds. She may have nothing or next to nothing, but she knows that what is more important, what is worthwhile in life, worth living for, is to share what you have with those who have none.
The woman's plight humanises the casualties of politics and religion when they're not played out for the least of the least. Because even at this point in our scriptures, it was already a command of God to care for widows and orphans, to look out for those who didn't have and had no way to support themselves. There was already a biblical challenge for everyone in that community to do so. And yet here she is with the very last small amount of flour, a little bit of scraped together firewood and a drip of oil to make a patty, to make basically a bannock that she'll share with her son as their final food before sitting down to die of starvation. In our world today, women and children in situations of famine are sobering. Human rights organisations tell us that in natural disasters, including climate change, the effects are most strongly felt by women and children, particularly widows and orphans. Oxfam tells the story of a Ugandan woman named Martina during a time of severe drought. For Martina Longom in Kayokin village in Karamoja, the northeastern Uganda, the disappearance of the Alele bird is another sign that strange things are happening in the weather. In my parents' time, she says, the Alele bird would come and sing, signalling the rain, and everyone would join together in turn to cultivate. Now, we don't see the bird. We don't know when to cultivate, when to sow, and for the last 3 years the rain was late. In two of them there wasn't even enough rain for the sorghum to grow. Then last year the rains came as a flood. The weather's never been completely predictable in Uganda, no more than anywhere else, but in the last few years it's become increasingly unreliable, making life more difficult for people. People like Martina, who rely on farming to survive. In early 2008, 6 months after the worst floods in Uganda, most grain stores sat empty. To feed her family, like the widow of Zarephath, Martina is collecting what little firewood she can because she's trying to earn a living by collecting water and firewood for other people in the town. The lack of food and milk is making her children ill, so collecting firewood has to continue, but it's becoming more difficult. We travel further and further for firewood every year, she says, It takes us to less safe places. Deforestation is one of the many problems that the women's group in Kurokin is looking to resolve. Her story eerily echoes the passage in Kings 1. Both stories open with women collecting firewood, sticks to cook what meagre food they can find, and it's through the heartbreak of women who can't feed their children. Both stories require us to have compassion for decisions in our homeland that affect women in other parts of the world. Because just like Martina, the widow of Zarephath's story is about the effects of economic injustice. The powerful, like King Ahab and Jezebel, they are not starving. They live in the same drought-stricken area, and while they claim that the gods are on their side, the story reveals that our God is on the side ignored by policymakers, those who are starving, those who are suffering. God is not best seen in glorious victories or getting the best deal for us out of COP26. God is present amongst the lives of those most affected by the decisions made at COP26. Amen. We sing. Take this moment, time and space. We pray for others using this COP26 Sunday video provided by Tear Fund.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Creator God, who made all things, we acknowledge as your handiwork, we stand alongside all which you have created.
Trees, rivers, mountains and valleys, soaring birds, and scuttling creatures, all are held within your care.
Gydan gilydd rydym wedi ein creu I dy anrhydeddu a dy foli.
May we grow in our love and appreciation for your creation, and may our awe and wonder draw us closer to you, the God of all things.
Your kingdom come.
Your siddham paramandalathil seyyappaduvathu pola bhoomiyilum seyyappaduvathaaga.
The earth is the Lord's and everything in it.
For you so loved the world, the cosmos, the entirety of creation, of which we humans are just one part.
May we learn again how to care for this planet.
As we pause and consider the climate emergency, we remember that we're praying to the Lord of all the earth.
Give us today our daily bread.
Lord, grant us the wisdom to care for your earth.
Sharing your provision and goodness with all our neighbours.
Founded on the covenant of your love.
Lord God, you made the world and declared it was very good.
As temperatures rise, storms rage, forests burn, and islands sink, It is the people who have done the least to cause the climate crisis who are suffering the most.
We stand together in sorrow.
We ask for forgiveness, for you are the God of all, who restores all relationships when we repent.
Forgive us for decades of inaction and for not living in accordance with your will.
As we forgive those who sin against us.
I urge then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all those in authority.
World leaders gathered at COP26 carry a huge burden of responsibility over this world that you love so much.
We hold them in our prayers. May they have humble and wise hearts.
We pray for anointed diplomacy, boldness and conviction to show your love to those who have least.
We pray for unity among the nations and for compelling voices and leaders to rise up so that, miraculously, action will begin.
Tiwabe mphelela, tiwatu kulira mmanja mwanu, chifukatika mphela, mumamva.
Ototerane mwitwa osha.
But deliver us from evil.
May we remember that we are a global community. Our actions and choices affect one another.
Help us resist the temptation to make choices for our convenience and to consider how those choices affect our neighbors across the world.
Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth.
Help us respond with the radical love of Jesus.
A love that disrupts the status quo and sacrifices itself to bring restoration.
This is our responsibility.
This is our worship.
Lord, renew us in a steadfast spirit and cleanse our hearts.
Renew our minds and transform our lives.
Renew our world.
Car c'est à toi qu'appartiennent le règne, la puissance et la gloire.
Now and forever. Amen.
And we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. We sing to God's glory, thinking of COP26 and the huge decisions ahead for our governments that will affect all of us. Hopefully bringing justice to the poorest and perhaps discomforting us who are some of the richest people in the world. Lord, bring the day to pass. Thank you for joining me for worship. It's been lovely to spend time with you. I hope today we've opened your eyes a little to what the scriptures might be saying about the poorest of the poor and how our need to care for the poorest of the poor and learn from them, from their strength, from their hospitality, their generosity, their ability to overcome, might be just what we need at a time like this. So thank you for being part of our church. Next week, it's Remembrance. If you're coming to the building, we start at 10:50. So we start 10 minutes early so that we can have a silence at 11 a.m. And we look forward to seeing you there. In the meantime, go safe, be well, and may the love of God that surpasses all human understanding guard your hearts and thoughts in Christ Jesus. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and be with those whom you love, for this day and forevermore. Amen.